Hello, just another video, a screencast, which is talking about this decomposition of the disk into lunes. In particular, what I want to do is compare it to a traditional way of decomposing a disk into wedges, because this is another way of talking about the area of a circle. In some ways, this is where I started all this many years ago. So let's look at this first. This is something that was well known to the ancient Greeks in the sense that we can cut a circle into sectors or wedges, and we can rearrange those wedges into a strip by alternating them. So you'll notice what I've done is I've taken the left-hand and right-hand semicircles and they're color-coded. What we can do is we can increase the number of wedges, and as we get more and more, the shape on the right becomes more and more like a rectangle, and we can push it all the way to infinity. There we go. So we've got an infinite number of wedges there, and they've all become smooshed together to make that grey rectangle on the right. So that's essentially the idea. Now, this was known to the ancient Greeks, and it was used to demonstrate that the area of a circle was half times the circumference times the radius. And that is because by the time we go more and more wedges, we've got half the circumference down the right hand side, so that's pi times r, half the circumference on the other side, and we've got the radius from left to right. And in the limit, this becomes precise. Right, so that's six wedges back here going all the way up to infinity. I think I've even got four there. Right, so that's our base view. Now, one of the things about this is that mathematicians like to talk about functions. So we can talk about a function from the shape on the left, from the disk, across to the strip on the right. And the thing you'll notice about it is that if we stay within one region, this thing is nicely well behaved, as you'd expect, but we jump over a boundary and it jumps on the right-hand side. This is what we call a discontinuity. So this function is discontinuous at the boundaries, but most of the time, almost everywhere, which is what mathematicians call it, almost everywhere this function is discontinuous. There's also the discontinuity as you go from the left to the right, which jumps from the green to the orange, and you notice that creates a discontinuity as well. And you can investigate what this one does. Now, the interesting thing is we can actually throw two points in here, right? So this one's just doing exactly the same, and you can see it's doing the same by doing that. But we can compare what's happening with two points. And one of the interesting things is we can make f of a close to f of b, where a and b aren't terribly close to each other. That's interesting. Right? We can do that in many ways. We can just find the points that we have to choose. And if we're careful, choosing near the boundaries of the wedges, we can get those fairly close to each other. And what does that mean in the limit? You might think it's got something to do with discontinuity. Well, as we get more and more of these, this discontinuous function actually becomes smoother and smoother. Right? So it's as though the discontinuities, they become a lot less discontinuous. And in the limit, it becomes perfectly continuous, the way we get from the disk to the rectangle. And the property that we could make f of b close to f of a, well, we can actually do it absolutely precisely. There we go. And we can do it pretty much at any point on the right. We can find two points on the left that work. There we go. It's not too hard to figure out the equations that make that all work. So I'm not going to go into them here. It's just a qualitative demonstration. All right, so we got this function from the disk to the rectangle that seems to preserve area, but it's got a problem in that it's not one-to-one. Mathematicians call a function that's one-to-one is if you can never have this happening. Or the other way we could say is that it's not a bijection, or you could actually say that it's two-to-one. Two points on the left become one point on the right. The other thing to notice is that we still have the discontinuity here at the boundary. We don't get rid of that in doing all of this. That's fairly obvious why that happens, right? So we've got something which is almost everywhere continuous. It's 2-to-1 or it's not 1-to-1. but it does map the circle to the rectangle in an area preserving way. Now let's compare this with the lune map. Right, so we've got the same thing we saw before. We've got the lunes cut out of the circle, and we're interested in rearranging those into a strip and increasing the number of lunes. All right, so we can increase that towards infinity. Right, so we've got this limiting version of this map. Now, just as with the wedges, this thing has jumps in it whenever you cross a boundary. In particular, when you cross this cut boundary, it bounces from the bottom to the top of the strip. We don't have a rectangle, of course. We've got something which is equivalent to a rectangle. We've got a semicircle at the top and the bottom, which we need to move around a little bit, but I'm not going to ignore that. That's easy to deal with. But we've got these discontinuities, but in the limit, they go away. So this thing is nice and smooth in the limit. And in fact, we could write a nice equation for it built out of continuous functions, our regular functions of algebra and trigonometry, which allow us to get, this is continuous except for where we've got to cross that cut. But the other thing, of course, we've got to look at is whether this function is one-to-one. And what you'll find is that you can actually only ever find a single point to make this work. So if I want to get f of a matching f of b, the only way to do it is to have a is equal to b, which is actually the definition of being bijective that mathematicians use. Of course, we've got what's going on at the boundary, which we need to deal with, but that's essentially covered by saying that set is negligible. It's of measure zero or area zero. And so almost everywhere, this function is one-to-one, it's continuous, and it maps the area of the disk to the area of the strip in an area preserving fashion. So that's the difference between these two maps, and it's what makes them useful for the purposes we're going to put them to in these discussions. Right, that's all I'm going to say about this for now.